laughter in our hearts, we hear laughter in our ears, in our head. And there's that wonderful sense of it's okay to be foolish. And have you ever heard, oh, they're just being foolish? And I'm going to give it to she's going to be able to be foolish today. That's what associate pastors get. You never know what the pastor's going to do. Because this whole idea of people laughing at you, so many people think, oh, that's awful. I don't want anybody to laugh. I don't want people to think that I'm nothing but serious academic with my mind and equations and all of these wonderful philosophies. Well, for me, I've always enjoyed that sense of being the clown. Being the one in the center, being the one that it's okay for people to laugh at. And that I went back, and clowns have been so important throughout history. The court jester is the one that started out, but before that, Dr. Eileen was talking to me about the fact that in the Druid, philosophy, the bards, there was a whole thing about comedic energy and how awe-inspiring it is and how wonderful it is. So when you think about, why can't I just have fun? Why can't I enjoy life? Where did I hear, don't do that? People are going to think you're funny. Oh, no. People might think I'm funny. Oh. And I go, yes. I think one of my favorite stories, and started out when I was 5 years old, and many of you have heard this before because it's so typical me. I went to first grade, and I came home. I was so excited. Mom, guess what? I can go on the bars. And they said, she said, okay. And I said, and you know, if you put one leg over and you turn real fast, you can get going really fast. And she said, okay, but I don't think that's too good of an idea for you because, you know, the boys might see your underwear. I really like the bars. So the next day I came home and said, Mom, guess what? I went on the bars and you can go backwards and it's so much fun. You can turn inside out and it's great. And she said, but Dottie, remember what I said? I said, don't worry, Mom. I took off my underwear. She gave me a pair of shorts. Mother was always there taking care of me. And virtually keeping my ass covered. But I found out that I could have fun even though other people said, no, you can't have fun.
That's right.
For whatever reason.
That was good.
Okay? And going through life like that, I have never been this beautiful little thin person. I've always been this zofty, voluptuous body.
Yeah.
For me, some of the things that people say, well, you have to be, didn't apply. So I wrote my own script. And that writing your own script is so amazing. That being delightfully funny. And how many of you remember when you were in high school or in college, there was somebody that was funny and it made you laugh? And when I got to looking at that, where does that go around the world? Well, I have this story there again that some of you might heard of about when NASA sent a bunch of people to Mars. And that might be happening soon. And they had all these people that they trained. The medical people were going to Mars. They were going to be gone for nine and a half, 10 years. And they had they even had a bishop that was going to bring about that wonderful feeling of God. And John Hopkins sent somebody, NASA sent somebody. Every group that you can imagine on the planet sent somebody. And away they flew. And while they were up there, there was this guy, and his name was Joe. And Joe dropped things. And Joe always was the center of any joke. Because no matter what happened, Joe was there to make fun of it. And everybody teased him and laughed at him. And the whole trip, when things got too serious, Joe did something. And they go, oh, that's a Joe for you. Yeah, there's Joe. And finally, when they landed, all the trucks came up. Trucks from NASA. Trucks from Lockheed Martin, trucks from John Hopkins. All these trucks came up and got these astronauts. And there was a huge round of applause. And out the back of the plane walked Joe. And as he walked across the tarmac, he got into a little tiny car that said Ringling's Barnum and Bailey. The clown is what saved the whole turning, the whole trip. For them to have just been caught up in the mathematics of it all, and the living. It's not living if you can't laugh. And so when you think of laughter, just think of all the times when you've looked at something so seriously, and yet, if you turned it around, it would have become funny. The time you've tripped. How many of you have ever tripped and you were immediately, I didn't do that. And everybody's looking at you, you fool. And instead of saying, oh my God, look at me, I tripped, and not trying to cover it up. It's that covering up that we do. And if you just enjoy it and say, that's me. Yes, David?
Mine is like, I'll trip and I'll fall and I'll get arrested. For my next trick, I'll be doing
it. For your next trick, you'll be doing it. Yes.
Have a nice trip.
See
the next fall.
But think about the ways that you can lighten up your life. I know that every Sunday we try and do something that shows the laughter that we have in our life, the things that happen. But children laugh between 100 to 200 times a day.
Wow.
And people say, oh, I wish they'd grow up. I wish we'd all grow down. Yeah. I wish we'd all laugh 100, 200 times a day. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the Baha'i faith, but my parents were Baha'is. And there was a wonderful gentleman named William Sears that wrote a book called God Loves Laughter. And I used to read that when I was growing up, that truly God did not say, Mother, Father, God, however you view the divine, the creator, didn't say, I'm going to put you on earth and I want you to be miserable. Mm-hmm. If you think about that, you know, we're not here to relish the misery. We're here to have fun with the joy. And what happens is when we laugh, we kind of jiggle a bit. We massage our whole insides when we laugh. A good belly laugh does that.
Yes.
We get exercise from laughing. And they have proven the more you laugh, the more weight you're going to lose. You can lose 4 pounds a year by laughing. Now, doesn't that make sense?
Yes.
I've never heard that being depressed, you're going to lose 4 pounds a year. You know?
That's right.
Think about that. There are so many things that you can laugh at that you might have completely ignored. And one of them is your kids. You know, I hear parents say, well, you can't do that. Don't you do that. You know, you can't spin around. You can't. And I go, wait a minute. They are having fun. And it's as if adults say, the minute you reach 23, you can't have fun anymore. You know. Well, I can say at 78, I'm still having fun.
Yay!
You know? And I expect to keep doing it. And you know that birthday song that we sang? I told somebody on my tombstone, I want to say, this is your birthday song. It isn't very long. And I thought, you know, that's me. I'm going to enjoy every aspect and everything that happens of what I can do. And the other thing is that as you laugh, you not only exercise yourself, but you produce endorphins. Okay? And it's like, have you ever talked to somebody about sex? Mm-hmm. And they go, oh yeah, my sex life. Why don't you laugh about it? Why is sex the funniest thing to people do? When you think about all the things that go into it, it's funny. And so why not just laugh? Because it's that prayer that we do. It's a spiritual prayer. It's an energy prayer. It's a prayer of attitude that we do that is absolutely so fantastic. I have a wonderful friend that I've brought, and Carolyn, this little eye over here, this is our $1 million duck. You might have to like put him down on the altar, but watch him because he likes to hurl himself all the way
back a little ways.
Okay, you ready? Can you sing with me?
If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, and your face will surely glow. And if you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. If you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. If you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. And if you're happy and you know it, and your face will surely glow. And if you're happy and you know it, stomp your feet. And if you're happy and you know it, shout hooray!
Hooray!
that silly? Was that funny? Yes, it was. And did it make you feel good? That's silly enough. That's our $1,000 duck.
$1,000. It's $1,000.
She was in Boomtown, and she said, I like that duck. It's silly. And if I win some money, I'm going to buy that duck. She won $1,000. And we don't know whether the duck helped. We're saying it does. We're betting on the duck.
Wanted to be duck.
Yeah. And so you want to know that when you truly want something, what do? You say, that's mine. And that's what she did. She said, that duck's mine. I'm going to get it, but I got to win some money to get it because it was $29.95. That's an awful big price to pay for a duck, right? So there it is. That's our CCL duck. And so the other thing for me is many of you know that I lost my hair when I was quite young. It's like, how do you lose your hair? Well, I didn't walk down the street and miss it. I mean, it came out slowly, but it was one of those things that I worked in the fields. For any of you who have been farm workers working in fields, bless you. It's hot, mm-hmm. it's nasty work, it's dirty, and it's from sun up to sundown because we owned a dairy. And I think it's one of the hardest jobs that you can have. So what happens is, during this period of time, I was blonde and I don't perspire. And so I'd go out in the fields, nobody told me to wear a hat. And the hotter it got, the more my wonderful head, all of the pores started opening. And because I got so hot, I'd pour cold water on my head. Well, our dermatologist said the cold water on my head magnified the sun, and it went right down into the roots of my hair and killed my hair. So by the time I was 20, I was wearing a pastiche. You guys don't know, it's a kind of hair toupee on the top, right? And then as I got older, I just had less and less hair. So what I did is I decided I'm going to wear wigs. Now, not this little one, I'm going to wear a full wig. Well, the wigs and I had quite a problem because they never seemed to stay on my head. And I got some, it was just like, well, that's the way it goes. I'd walk into anywhere and just take off my wig and throw it. You know, it was kind of like, well, you know, you heard of throw your hat in the room? I always throw my wig in the room. And for people who knew and loved me, it was like, it was great. For other people, they thought it was strange. And I liked that too, you know. So I was a paralegal in my younger years. And one day I was going into the Los Angeles County Courthouse to file some papers. And the wind was blowing. And just as I'm walking towards the steps, a gust of wind caught my wig, and it rolled it like a tumbleweed down the road. Well, there was one of LA's finest there, a wonderful patrolman, who decided he was going to go catch my wig. But when he caught it, he didn't know what to do with it. You know, as it were alive, he might have thought it was at that point. And so he came and gave it back to me. Well, you don't just put a wig on. You have to look in the mirror. As my dear friend Byron Floyd once told me, I had it on backwards. But that day I had it on frontwards. So I took it and I put it under my arm. So it looked like I had one hairy armpit. And I walked into the courthouse and the guard stopped me and he said, hi. He'd watched the whole thing. I said, hello. And he said, do you need help? And I said, no, I'm fine. He looked like he doubted it. So I went in and filed the papers. And the court clerk was just so cool. She didn't say a word. She just kind of looked at me. And I came out. And the next day, I had to go get the papers that I'd filed. So I had my wig on and I got a little scar. And I walked by and the guard stopped me. He said, excuse me, ma'am. I said, yes. He said, I went home and told my family all about you, and they're wondering if you'll come to dinner. I don't know what kind of family he had or what kind of dinner it was going to be. I said, I'm sorry, I live 80 miles away because I lived in Lancaster and I was in LA and I have to go home. And he said, oh, okay. But he looked really disappointed that I wasn't going to be able to share my story or whatever he thought it was. And so it was kind of fun. Well, the other time, I went to see Bette Midler at Bimbo's 360, 350, whatever it is. And she put on a great show. And I'm walking out. Now, honestly, my wigs never looked like real hair. I had a blonde afro that was quite high. I had another blonde one that was really tight and curly, but kind of always set askew, you know, so nobody was ever fooled that this was my real hair. And so I came walking out, and this guy walks up, and he goes, "Oh, honey, I love your hair." Well, you know, he was being sarcastic.
Oh, yeah.
So I gave it to him. Well, not only was he, oh my God, you know, he fell off the curb into the street, but I turned around because everybody was laughing to see Bette Midler going, right on, you know? And so, but I think the most embarrassing for my family was one day I had taken my wig off after work and it was in the back seat. And my sister Sierra and I went into the grocery store. And she was flirting with the grocery checker. And he was going, "Hi, how are you?" "Well, hi, how are you? Don't I know you?" "Yeah, I go to college." "Yeah, I go to college." You know that, you know, her voice got kind of high and they were giggling and laughing. And he said, "Can I help you with your groceries and stuff?" She said, "Oh, sure." And he said, "Oh, good. Maybe I'll see you tomorrow at class." "Oh, yeah." So we go out, he opens the door, and he throws the groceries in, and he goes, "Oh, my God, I killed your dog." She didn't talk to me all the way home. I'm not going to talk about this. And so for me, all of those things and those jokes, I always thought they were funny, but other people around me kind of looked at, there she goes again. We never know quite what she's going to do. And when I was talking to somebody, they said, "You know, you can heal yourself with humor." I said, "What are you talking about?" He said, "Norman Cousins wrote a book called Anatomy of an Illness about healing himself of a very, very difficult chronic disease." And it was called ankylosing spondylitis?
Yes.
Yeah. And they told him that it was chronic and it was incurable. And he said, "I don't think that's the case." And he went off all the drugs. And all he went on was vitamin C. And he sat in his hotel room across from the hospital, because he wasn't stupid. He wouldn't be still being checked. And he started watching Marx Brothers and I Love Lucy and everything he could on a projector that he felt was going to make him laugh. And he laughed and he laughed. And his immune system got stronger and stronger. And he healed himself. And it was only one out of 500 people that ever healed themselves of this disease. And he did it through laughter. And Norman Cousins started talking and writing a book about how you can do this. And how many times do you hear that somebody has a disease or you yourself have something, and what you do is you go into despair? Think about finding people around you who laugh, who are funny, and look at things that are funny. I don't watch the news very much, and I try to not listen to the news. And I watch comedies. And I love that what we had in our, you know, every week we do a CCL Insights. And in these CCL Insights, I said, so if you laugh, you know, watch reruns of Friends, or watch reruns of I Love Lucy, or the Big Blank Theory. I don't know how I change it from Big Bang to Big Blank, but that made me laugh. And Kirk said, "Do you want to change it?" "No, I like that. That's even better. You know, the Big Blank Theory. It sounds like my life." And so we didn't do it. So, and for those of you who are afraid of God, how many of you were raised to fear God? A lot of us were. "Oh, you better watch out, or God's going to get you. You better watch out, or you're going to go to hell. You better watch out, or something." And so for you, that God energy was this negative being that was watching everything you did. And, you know, "You better not do that, or God's going to get you." And I was lucky enough to be raised by people who, when they changed different religions, my folks went through five religions as I was growing up, with Catholicism and Methodist and a little bit of Jewish and Baha'i and some Buddhist thrown in there. All of those religions, they kept showing me the good part of it, where God was loving and kind and cheerful, and the Creator was a positive being. And it was okay for me to do the things that I was doing. And that, what a change in life when you can say, my life is working. because I'm happy. Mm-hmm. Okay? And a lot of that happiness is by finding ways to be foolish. Those of you who are into the tarot, the fool is this wonderful card. And a lot of people say, I don't want to be connected with the fool, because it's just stepping off a cliff with a feather in its hand. And it's not because the fool thinks it can fly. It's because the fool knows that everything's going to be okay. Mm-hmm. And that's not foolish. That is that place where we all want to go. That's that place that all religions talk about. When you accept the fact that everything is going to be fine and joyful, and that we act, it's the same as the jesters of old. When the jesters would go to, the kings would hire the jesters to be their conscience. The jester was the one they told all the stories to about what they were really doing. The jester not only entertained, they were quite often a magician. They were quite often the spiritual part of the court. They were that energy. Through laughter, they found things could be changed. So if the king was in a very bad mood, they'd call for the jester to cheer him up. And each one of us has a jester in our life. It's that part of us that makes us laugh. And yet, we kind of shut it down. It's inappropriate. You can't do that. For those of you who knew my good friend, Byron Floyd, I don't know why Byron and I got together. Byron was this gorgeous black gay man, and I'm me. And we met and went, and it got to the point people say, where's Byron? What if I showed up, or vice versa?
I know.
And you know Byron. Yeah, we have quite a few. We all knew Byron. And he was, you know, he was amazing. And he and I would get together, and we would laugh so hard at so many different things. And he would do things like, he was the one girlfriend. You got your wig on backwards. I said, how does it look? No, it's amazing. It looks pretty damn good. But he watched me from a little ways, and the more he got to know me, we became silly together. And we laughed together. And to have a companion that you can laugh with, they think you're wonderful, and you still love each other, you know. And I had the honor of being at his bedside when he passed and holding his hand. And I was there, and he said, God. And he couldn't say another word. He was at that point in his passing that he couldn't even talk. And I said, yes. You know how you're waiting for that moment of clarity when somebody is in that process? And he wrote a little note to me, and it said, you're standing on my oxygen line. Was, but anyway, but that was his way of saying, I'm still here. Yeah. You know, I might not look like I'm still here, but I am. And I hope every one of you has a dear friend that you can have fun with, that you can say, yes, we can laugh. And if you think, I'm too sophisticated to laugh and have fun, you're missing out on a lot of life. It is funny. You look at the politicians and you go, oh my God, laugh. It's funny. You know, you look at your own immortality. It's funny. You know, hey, I'm here and I better enjoy it. No, we're not too sure where you're going from here. I had an incident in January where I think I made that transition into that place. I went to a place that was all white. There was no fear, anger, frustration, sickness, whatever. And I was in this room. And I was there until my spirit guide gave me some incidents to look at that brought me back. But that place I was so sacred, it's so special. And I know now that when I leave this planet, I'm going to go somewhere that's really, really special and honoring and pleasant. I'm not going to go somewhere where I'm going to be having to deal with eternal fires. Because I've done enough, I could warrant that if I thought about it. It's really out there. So, as the Marx Brothers saved Norman Cousins, and as the Big Bang Theory is something that I enjoy watching, think about what is it that you would like in your life that makes you giggle, that makes you laugh? And Gloria, Gloria, where'd the basket go? We have a basket around here.
We have a couple of them. That's not mine yet, is it?
No, we're going to pass this basket. And if you want to read a joke, pick one of these out, okay? Yes, Carolyn.
I want to read a joke.
Okay. I'll be right there.
And if you're not in the mood of reading a joke, while we're passing it out, I want to talk to you about what we're going to be doing right after church. Don't start reading yet. I'll call on you. But after church, we're going to be releasing your prayers. All the prayers that have been in the little brown bowl, our wonderful Reverend April Lucier is going to burn them and release them to the Creator. So please, would you stay after church and do that? And April, while we're passing out the jokes, would you stand up and introduce yourself? The other two candidates, were you CM minister yet?
Come on up to the front.
This is
the girl. Up to the front. Always. You can do it. And she's energetic.
Hi, I'm Reverend April Lucier. I've been a member of UCM since 1982.
Wow!
And when I moved here to California, it was the first thing I did was find a spiritual community. And actually, my spirit guide said, look it up in the phone book. Oh, yeah, they're kissing. And sure enough, under metaphysics, there was Center for Infinite Growth, which is one of our charter churches. So it's time, I think, for me to step up and take a stronger role in leadership. And so I've decided to run for the board.
Thank you very much, April. April also is in charge of the goddess side of
meditation tomorrow night.
And meditation tomorrow night. We mentioned that. Thank you so very much. Okay. All right. Who is going to read the first joke? Okay, Annie. You got loud enough so everybody can hear.
I'm loud enough. I wanted to first say that yesterday I had a great time because I went through a store yesterday and every, you know how they play the music or in this case it wasn't music, it was actual real songs, rock and roll songs, whatever. Every single song that they played was something that Weird Al has done a parody of. So I was walking through the aisles of the store singing Weird Al's words. I don't know if I got any books or not, but I just didn't care. So, you know, so that's always a good way to have fun, too. So I'm walking around going, I bought on eBay. You know? Okay, fine. Great truths about growing old. Number one, growing old is mandatory. Growing up is optional.
Yay. Yeah.
So, number two, forget the health food. I need all the preservatives I can get. Number three, when you fall down, you wonder what else you can do while you're down here. Number four, you're getting old when you get the same sensation from a rocking chair that you used to get from a roller coaster. Number five, it's frustrating to me, you know all the answer, but nobody bothers to ask you any questions.
Okay, great, thank you.
Mine is Law of the Bath. When the body is fully immersed in water, the telephone rings.
Okay, David.
Okay.
Read it?
Sure. Thunderstorm Company. One summer evening, during a violent thunderstorm, my mother was tucking her small boy into bed. She was about to turn off the light when he asked in a tremoring voice, Mommy, will you sleep with me tonight? She smiled and gave him a reassuring hug. I can't, dear. I have to see your dad and daddy's room. And there's a long silence. And it was only broken by the last shaking little voice saying, the big sissy.
Okay, who's next? Yes, Deb.
A young boy came to Sunday school late. His teacher knew that he was usually very prompt and asked him if anything was wrong. The boy replied no, that he was going fishing, but his dad told him that he needed to go to church. The teacher was very impressed and asked the boy if his dad explained to him why it was more important to go to church than to go fishing, to which the boy replied, yes, he did. Dad said he didn't have enough faith for the both of us.
Five-year-old Becky answered the door when the census taker came by. She told the census taker that her daddy was a doctor and wasn't home because he was performing an appendectomy. My, said the census taker, that sure is a big word for such a little girl. Do you know what it means? She replies, sure, $1,500, and that doesn't even include the anesthesiologist.
This is 10 great truths about life that little children have learned. No matter how hard you try, you can't baptize cats. If your mom is mad at your dad, don't let her brush your hair. If your sister hits you, don't hit her back. They always catch the second person. Never ask your 3-year-old brother to hold a tomato. You can't trust dogs to watch your food.
Well, that's for sure.
Don't sneeze when someone is cutting your hair.
Ooh.
Never hold a dustbuster and a cat at the same time. Now my kids tried this one. You can't hide a piece of broccoli in a glass of milk. Don't wear polka dot underwear under white shorts.
Mm-hmm.
I think I did that one. The best place to be when you're sad is Grandpa's lap.
Yes, Carolyn.
9-year-old Aaron came home from the playground with a bloody nose, black eye, and torn clothing. It was obvious he'd been in a bad fight and lost. While his father was patching him up, he asked his son what happened. Well, Dad, said Aaron, I challenged Larry to a duel, and you know, I gave him his choice of weapons. Uh-huh, said the father, that seems fair. I know, but I never thought he'd choose his sister.
After attending a wedding for the first time, a little girl whispered to her mother, why is the bride dressed in white? Because white is the color of happiness, and today is the happiest day of her life. The child thought about this for a moment and then said, so why is the groom wearing black?
Great truths about life that adults have learned. 1, raising teenagers is like nailing Jell-O to a tree. 2, wrinkles don't hurt. 3, families are like fudge, mostly sweet with a few nuts. 4, today's mighty oak is just yesterday's nut that held its ground.
Yeah.
Laughing is good exercise, it's like jogging on the inside. And the last one, middle age is when you choose your cereal for the fiber, not the toy.
A second grader came home from school and said to her grandmother, Grandma, guess what? We learned how to make babies today. The grandmother, more than a little surprised, tried to keep her cool. That's interesting, she said. How do you make babies? It's simple, replied the girl. You just change the Y to
A man took his little boy to the zoo for the very first time. Each time they would see a new animal, the little boy would ask, what's that? And each time the father would explain. When they came to a pen with a very large bird inside, the father said, and that, Timmy, is a stork. The boy stood there for a few minutes and then began to wave, saying, hi, I'm Timmy. After several times of repeating this, he finally turned to his father and exclaimed, guess I'm all grown up, Dad. He doesn't recognize me.
I need you,
everyone.
Oh, yes.
I'll take the tambourine. Okay, the law of physical surfaces. The chances of an open-faced jelly sandwich landing face down on a floor covering are directly correlated to the newness and cost of the carpeting.
Yeah. Lee.
I hope this doesn't happen at our church anyway. After the church service, a little boy told the pastor, "When I grow up, I'm going to give you some money." "Well, thank you," the pastor replied, "but why?" The little boy replies, "Because my daddy says you're one of the poorest preachers we've ever had."
This one's work-related.
Oh, no, don't read that
one. Boss called one of his employees into the office. "Rob," he said, "you've been with the company for a year. You started off in the post room. 1 week later, you were promoted to a sales position. And 1 month after that, you were promoted to district manager of the sales department. Just 4 short months later, you were promoted to vice chairman. Now it's time for me to retire, and I want you to take over the company. What do you say to that?" "Thanks," said the employee. "Thanks," the boss replied. "Is that all you can say?" "Well, I suppose not," the employee said. "Thanks, Dad."
When my grandson asked me how old I was, I teasingly replied, "Gee, I'm not sure." And the boy says, "Hey, look in your underwear, Grandma. Mine says I'm 4 to 6.
"My grandson Billy and I entered our vacation cabin. We kept the lights off until we were inside to keep from attracting pesky insects. Still, a few fireflies followed us in. Noticing them before I did, Billy whispered, 'It's no use, Grandpa. The mosquitoes are coming after us with flashlights.'"
After tucking your 3-year-old child, Sam, in one night in bed, his parents heard sobbing coming from his room. They rushed back in and found him crying hysterically. And he managed to tell them that he had swallowed a penny and he was sure he was going to die. And no amount of talking was going to help him relax. His father, in an attempt to calm him down, palmed a penny and pretended to pull it out of his ear. Sammy was all excited. Well, in a flash, Sammy snatched the penny out of his dad's hand, swallowed it, and then cheerfully demanded, "Dad, do it again!"
Oh, no!
Okay, how does that make you feel?
You guys know that I like kids, right? This is one of my babies, right? I stand up, Nicole. This is my baby.
Yay!
This is my brother. Stand up, Mark. This guy has saved my life 3 times.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Wonderful. Welcome. And oh, while you're standing, you're going to read one. I love it.
That's why I did that.
New scam. The new scam has been pulled mainly on older women who are currently past the age of giving a running pursuit. What happens is that the unattended victim stops on the red light, and a completely nude, a good-looking, nicely tanned, unbelievably well-enhanced young man comes up, such as myself. That doesn't say that. With muscles flexing and the body stretched to its full potential, he pretends to wash her windshields. While doing so, another person opens her back door and takes anything that he can, and they become very good at it. And the victim says, "They got me 7 times Friday, 7 times Sunday, and I couldn't find them on Monday."
Okay, thank you so very much for being with us. Now, and what's going to happen, Carolyn's going to do this. For all of you who had the guts to be foolish today, you're going to get a doctorate of joy and laughter. So,
woo-hoo!
Okay.
Okay,
and a choir.